This is Ham Radio Now, episode 292 from the 2016 ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference, St. Petersburg, Florida. Way last September, last year. Yeah, I know. PiGate, Emergency Email Gateway. Interesting talk. This is going to be presented by Mark Griffith, KD0QYN. Little diversion before we get there. In the last episode, I had a little bit of information in the kids section of the underwriting from about a podcast, QSO Today podcast, with the guest as Brooke Allen, N2BA. And I was looking up Brooke on the web, and I was looking up PiGate on the web. I wanted to show you something about both. I forgot to show you the cool thing that I found about Brooke Allen. N2BA. And so I'll show you that, and then I'll show you the PiGate thing. So this is the Brooke Allen part. I just looked, you know, Googled N2BA, and what I found were all these aircraft references. I mean, I found Brooke. He's in here somewhere. Yeah, QRZ.com. But all of these aircraft references were also here. And as it turns out, and this is something I've known for a while, and you might have known it too, that the FAA that gives out the call letters for aircraft and the FCC, which gives out call letters for hams, accidentally kind of overlapped each other. So you can get an aircraft call letters that are in the N and a number and two letters, the same as an extra class ham radio call. So you can have an aircraft that is N2BA and a ham that is N2BA. And I believe that there's a few instances of hams that have aircraft. I don't think that's Brooke's aircraft. I don't know. That have the same call letters. Otherwise, there can be a little bit of a conflict like that. And just the N in the letter and N in a number and two letters. I think that's the only overlap. Okay, so what about the PiGate? So I wanted to show you that too. And that came up first. Searched for PiGate, P-I-G-A-T-E. And like I say, that's what came up. Oh, stop it. Come back here. That's what came up first. But those letters also spell PIG-8, P-I-G-A-T-E, same thing. And so a bunch of PiGate. PiGate my pizza evidently is the thing. That's not what I wanted to show you. This is what I wanted to show you. The PiGate is emergency email gateway. Mark's goal for this project was to design and build a super simple, ultra-portable system for using amateur radio to send and receive email in disaster situations when all else fails, as we say, without carrying in a wheelbarrow full of equipment and wires and, as he says, taking 2 days to set it all up. It's almost seen that. You know, a ham shows up to do some sort of public service activity, emergency activity. He's got an armload of radios and he's, bumbling around trying to get everything all hooked up. Not the professional image that we want to show. So maybe this PiGate thing is going to help out. Before we get to that, Ham Radio Now brought to you by you, the viewer, hamradionow.tv. Arvin will meet you there and guide you to our contribution page if you want to help out. However, the Tapper conferences were mostly funded by the Kickstarter that we ran last year. And 75 hams contributed in the Kickstarter, three of those at the $500 corporate underwriter level. And we give them a little bit more time here. So we start with Tapper themselves. Tapper sponsors the DCC, and they're going to be at Dayton or Greene County, as the case may be, with the banquet, stuff like that. So if you're interested in anything digital in ham radio, stop by tapper.org, recommend membership, and maybe I'll see you at the DCC or the Greene County Ham Fest coming up this year. We are also sponsored by this fella. He is Chud. Let me get my information on Chud. From Node Systems Limited, his call signs are M1PUP, 2E1BXW. Chud is in London, UK-based Worldwide Projects, providing technical project management, design and build, and telecommunication systems, security systems, SCADA, command and control systems, mainly in the police, ambulance, and rail sectors. And if you stop by Chud's Twitter page here, let me get the full screen on that, 506,000 tweets. He's very prolific. You'll see, if you follow him, you'll see a lot. He's following a couple thousand people. He has even more following him. And some interesting and, you know, semi-oddball stuff. And you can tell from his picture. He's a cool guy. Contact him by email, chud@nodesystems.co.uk. That's chud@nodesystems.co.uk. Follow him on Twitter here at Node Systems. Now for the kid stuff. You know, I haven't talked very much about what the ARRL does. They do a lot. Now, Brooke, in the last episode, I was talking about Brooke a little bit. And his interview in the QSO today, he goes in some very different directions. And I haven't gone the ARRL direction very much. They're, you know, pretty traditional in what they do in ham radio, in their outlook to young people. So they do have a section on their website called Outreach to Youth. It's not too hard to find. So they got a lot of stuff in there. And let's see. Yeah, this page on, I've recommended that you go to your school and try to get some ham radio outreach going there. Terrific if you got a regular class started, but even if it's just making a demonstration or something. And you know, they've given a lot of thought to what you might need to bring to a school to convince them that ham radio would be an interesting part of their curriculum or after school curriculum, something like that. So that's a good place to go to look at the more traditional type of stuff. Now, how effective is it? Well, are we seeing hordes of young people streaming into ham radio? Not really, but these tools are available. And I keep saying that it's not up to Newington. They're not going to send someone to your school district to implement these tools. That's your job. So maybe there are better, fresher ways to reach potential young hams, but before we reinvent that wheel or invent a new one, maybe we should road test some of the wheels we've already got, or at least go take a look. So stop by here, ARRL, and outreach to teachers and schools and outreach to youth. It's really up to us. They're not going to do it from headquarters. Speaking of inventing new wheels, let's see what Marcus got in mind.
So for Saturday afternoon, the kickoff, a very exciting topic to keep you awake after your lunchtime festivities. So I'd like to introduce Mark Griffith, KD0QYN, and his talk on PiGate Emergency Email Server. Take it away.
Thank you. All right, I have a lot of slides to go through. I'll go through them pretty quickly to give us all, give you all an opportunity to have some questions at the end. So this is what we're gonna cover today, real quickly. How and why I thought this up, what my design process was, the specifics of the PiGate, some thoughts about some field use and also future development. So if you're looking for charts and graphs and all sorts of binary numbers and digital pictures, I don't have that. You're going to be disappointed. But hopefully you will like the slides that I have. And as it says, please hold all the questions until the end, because I'm sure that there will be a lot. And I'm going to try to give as much time as I can for that. Okay, so everybody in here, hands up. Who has a smartphone? Okay, keep your hands up if you can get email on it. Keep your hands up if you get a text message on it. Keep your hand up if you have it with you all the time. I mean, other than bedtime and when you're in the bathroom. And also keep your hand up if it'll alert you when you get a text message or an email. Okay, that's the vast majority of the people here. This is the way communications is done nowadays. If somebody wants to get a hold of you, they're gonna send you a text message or an email because they know that you're gonna get it. Let's go over to back to the year 2012. The HMS Bounty. HMS Bounty was a replica ship built in 1960 for the movie Mutiny on the Bounty, which was filmed in 1962. I think it starred Trevor Howard and Marlon Brando. And the HMS Bounty since that time has been used as a ship for various teaching purposes and excursions and things like that. So the Bounty was traveling south off the east coast of the United States in the October of 2012. Unfortunately for the Bounty, Hurricane Sandy was coming up. The two met, and it was unfortunate for the Bounty, it sank. Now, during the time that the Bounty was floundering and sinking, the captain of the ship used every means he had available to him to try and contact the Coast Guard for help. He had a satellite phone. He made calls on a satellite phone, couldn't get any results. He had HF radio. He tried using his HF radio to contact various HF marine nets. No help. He got on the VHF radio, made emergency calls on the VHF emergency frequencies. No help. So finally, out of desperation, he had an email address for the Coast Guard. So he got on his Winlink 2000 account, sent the Coast Guard an email, said, hey, we're sinking, here's my coordinates. In less than 60 minutes, planes were there. That included the amount of time it took for them to fly there, and they were 100 miles off the coast. Well, 14 lives were saved. Unfortunately, the captain, he died. He went down to the ship, and there was one other person who was actually a direct descendant of Fletcher Christian, who also died after as a result. But 14 lives were saved. So I thought to myself, that's pretty neat. What the heck is this Winlink 2000 system that gave this guy this capability? Real quickly, Winlink is a global amateur radio worldwide email system. It's all amateur radio. It's used by maritime and government and emergency communications agencies all over the world. In fact, there are several states and several national entities, I guess, national governments that use the Winlink 2000 system as their emergency communications. It's not a very small system. It's handled over 65,000 email messages in June this past year, in this past June. 780,000 annually. It's not a lightly used, small-time system. You access it through a radio message server, a radio mail server, and from there into the Winlink system and then the internet. They've got nearly 700 VHF packet and PAC-TOR stations around the world, which are the RMS stations. Here's a distribution of the PAC-TOR station. I'm sorry, the packet stations within the United States. And I blew up Florida over on the right-hand side. You can see in the Tampa Bay area here, we're pretty well covered. I don't know what those people in North Dakota and South Dakota are going to do. Nebraska, Kansas, I don't know. I guess they're going to have to use PAC-TOR.
Where's the rest of Florida?
Oh, that's, well, the rest of Florida and Key West, nobody cares down there. Oh, nobody cares about the panhandle.
It's covered by Mobile.
Yeah, it's covered by Mobile, that's it. Here's a distribution of the HF PAC-TOR stations around the world. So you can see that most of them are in the United States, but no matter where you are in the world, you're going to be able to reach an HF PAC-TOR station, probably. And that's what the captain of the Bounty did. So I thought to myself, how can I use this Winlink 2000 system for emergency communications? Obviously, sending an email works. It worked for the captain of the Bounty. It would work for all of you. How can I do that from within a disaster site? You're sitting in a spot where there's nothing left. Packet radio seems to be an answer, but it's obviously got limitations because it's VHF. PAC-TOR also seems to work. But a traditional packet station is not easy to set up. Same thing for HF Winmore. Winmore is the Winlink 2000 sound card-based HF radio application that they have. And they take a lot of tweaking to get this stuff set up correctly. And, of course, now we have traditional message handling. You know, you got your pad of your radiograms. You tear off a pad, you hand it to somebody, they fill it on out, they give it back to you, and what do? You get on your VHF radio and you transmit it by voice, or maybe you get on your BBS system, you transmit it to a BBS operator who on the other end does the same thing, writes it down. I mean, this is the stuff that we've been doing for 100 years. There's got to be a better way. Here's a traditional packet station. Thanks to the taper guys, I stole that from your website. You got your Intrepid operator on the left-hand side typing away at his Windows computer, talking to his TNC. He's got a bunch of wires that go there to his VHF radio, so more wires that go up to the antenna. Everything's located in the same room, probably, except for the antenna. There's probably lots of tweaking to set it up. You take this to a disaster site, you got to plug everything all in, you got to test it, you got to tweak it to get it to work. It's a little bit hard to set up. And it takes a lot of power, relatively speaking. You might have to have a generator with you to power all this stuff. But then how can you send email to the internet? Well, you can't. Even with the old BBS systems, you couldn't send email to the internet very easily. It was unless somebody forwarded for you. So I thought to myself some more, well, how can I use this new technology that we have in our pockets, emails on our smartphones? How can I merge the two together? Because amateur radio is obviously the method that always gets through. How can I get around with co-locating all this equipment? And then finally, how can I make it so simple that my wife can use it? And she knows that's there, and that was actually one of my goals. So this is my development process. This is my development goals then. When everything is down, nothing works. I want to be able to go to a disaster site and set up something and make a contact any email address in the world outside that disaster site. That's a pretty tall order. It's got to be portable. I want to be able to carry it in on my backpack. I don't want to have a truck to cart all the stuff in there and spend 2 days setting it all up. I want it to be completely self-contained. I walk in there, I turn it on, it's ready to go. I want it to have low power consumption so you can have extended battery life. I want to use all off-the-shelf hardware and software. I don't want to have to build myself a special kind of board. I don't want to have to write any special software other than whatever was necessary. I want it to have a common user interface, something that everybody's familiar with. Everybody here knows how to use email. If you don't, well, I'm sorry. Everybody knows how to do it. There's no training involved in getting people to use this stuff. You might have to do a little bit of training, but it'd be very little. I want it to be automated as much as possible. It just does things. And whatever minimal configuration it needs, I want it to be easy to do and easy to replicate. That's one of the other advantages. The result was the PiGate. This is it, the whole thing other than the radio. This was actually a special case by my friend Brent, W8XG, who made this nice little case with my call sign on here, my name, and PiGate on the side there. But this is the whole thing. I put it up here so you can see it, but it would fall down. So the hardware that you need to do this, a Raspberry Pi mini computer, a B+2 or 3, works the same with either one. A TNC Pi from John Hansen. Where's John Hansen? There's John. John Hansen from Coastal Chip Works. A mini SD card, 8 gigabyte, 16, 32, 64, 128, whatever. I use an 8 gigabyte minimum. If you're using a Pi 2, like this is a Pi 2, I got a little Wi-Fi dongle here. With a Pi 3, you don't need it because it's built in. A gain antenna on here helps a little bit. You need a 2 meter HF or 2 meter VHF transceiver, unless you're going to be doing HF, then you don't need that. Some cables to connect it to your radio. Here's a cable here. Plugs into the Pi. Here's the other end that plugs into my Baofeng. This actually works really nice. Hook this up to an antenna in my car. And I can connect to RMS stations 20 miles away. The 3D printed case. This is the case. It's a 3D printer file. Comes apart with a top and a bottom. You can download that and print it out yourself on your own 3D printer. You can take it to a university or a library. A lot of libraries will print them for you. A battery. 12-volt battery. The larger the better. This is a 7-amp-hour battery. This will run this PiGate for about 10 hours, just by itself. And then you need to have some sort of a cable to convert that 12 volts to 5 volts. This is one here is from PowerWorks. Runs from 10 volts to 32 volts, transfers it down to 5. Actually, this works. I've had the battery as low as 6 volts, and it was still powering the PiGate through this converter. That's all you need. Total is about $140, depending on where you get your stuff from. Raspberry Pi, I'm not going to go too much into that. We all know pretty much what they're like. But basically, it's a mini computer on the Raspberry Pi 3. It's got a 1.2 gigahertz 4-core processor with a gigabyte of RAM, all sorts of USB ports, Ethernet port, graphics. It's a fully functional computer. Some people may disagree with me on that name, but I've been in IT for over 30 years. It's does the same as any other computer I've ever used. You need a TNC Pi from Coastal Chipworks. This is actually an older version. John, maybe you can get me a newer version, a newer picture. It's low cost, $40 for the kit, $65 if you want them to assemble it for you, plugged right into the Raspberry Pi GPIO. That's all you have to do. You just plug it in. There's no setup. There's nothing. It's all configured in the software. It's got a DB9 interface right here that plugs to your, go to your radio. You have to make the cable yourself. It goes on my Yaesu radios at home. I use the the DB, it's not, what's that called? Not the DB9. Yeah, that jack for the microphone in the front for the transmit, and the speaker in the back for receive. Like I said, there's a one cable you have to build, four lines: receive audio, transmit audio, push talk and ground. That's it. You can also use the data ports on the back of your radio if it has it. You have to make the cable, a USB to serial dongle like this. Works great to go to a PacTor modem. Then you have to need if you're using a PacTor modem, you have to have a cable from that to your HF radio, which you can either buy or build it yourself. Now, the required pieces of software, there's several pieces of software. This was the hard part, getting all these pieces of software to work together. I don't know if anybody's done all this yet before. So you need a Raspbian image, the kernel version of 4.1.19 or less. The reason for that is because in 4.1.2, or 20, they introduced a bug, and the AX25 software doesn't hang up. So you can make a radio connection one time, and then the next one will fail until you reset it. So there's a bug in that. As far as I know, they're working on it. I don't think it's fixed yet. The last time I tried was a couple of months ago, and it still wasn't working. But this version of the kernel does everything that you need on the Pi anyway. There are several software packages that need to be integrated. The integration also of all this software was not easy to do. It took a while. And I've been in IT for 30 years, and that's what I do for a living. But once it's configured, hey, it's easy, because now you got an image, and all you got to do is copy that image. The first piece of software is PacLink Unix, written by a bunch of guys to provide a PacLink capability to Unix instead of just relying on the Windows software that's available. The first software I worked with, obviously, because unless I got that working, nothing else would work, supports three modes, a TNC mode to HF radio for packet, a serial port to your PacTor modem, or if you have an Ethernet port that's plugged into your Raspberry Pi that's working, you can use Telnet, which, of course, is infinitely faster than the other two modes. AX25, we all know pretty much that AX25 is the old X25 software used for banks and telecommunications back in the 70s. Modified in the 80s for amateur radio use, which is where the A in AX25 comes from. Mostly used back then for BBSs until the internet took over, and nobody uses BBSs anymore. On VHF, it's 1200 baud, 1200 bits per second. USF, it can be 9600 baud, but not from the PiGate, because John Hansen and I talked about that extensively. Maybe sometime in the near future, he might get the 9600 baud support on his TNC Pi, but it's not something that he's looking at the moment. There's no error correction on AX25, so you can lose data. There was a FX25, a forward error correction version that was presented in a paper here at the Taper conference 10 years ago, but I don't know if anybody has used it. I don't know anything more about it other than the paper was presented. PacTor. HF communications, there's three PacTor modes right now, or there's four. There's PacTor 1, which is all done on the ancient CAM Plus or PK232 hardware. I have a PK232 that I use for testing. PacTor 2 and 3 and 4 are proprietary modes by the SCS people out in Germany. And because they're proprietary, you can't implement them in any other way other than buying their modems. And they charge a lot for the modems. Like their latest PacTor 4 modem is like $2,000. You can get an older PacTor 2 modem on eBay for maybe $700 or $800. They have a newer one called the Baby Dragon, which I think runs for about $800 or $900. So it's a lot of money for most amateur radio operators. They don't want to spend more on their modem than they spend on their rig. The speeds range anywhere from 20 to 5200 baud. PacTor actually adjusts itself just to speed depending on the HF conditions at the time. PacTor 1 is roughly equivalent to RIDI on a good day. The Winmore application that is Windows only is about 2,800 baud on a good day. That's about the best you're going to get. Now, there's still no theoretical limit then on the range for PAC-TOR communication because it's HF. You could be working at a disaster site in Kansas and be able to send email to a from a site in radio RMS site in Germany. And it's an error-correcting protocol, so there is no data loss. So I had to also integrate this the host APD and ISC DHCP server. That's what enables the Wi-Fi hotspot on the PiGate. You communicate to the PiGate through its own Wi-Fi hotspot. When you turn it on, Wi-Fi hotspot named PiGate comes up. Now, if you're in a disaster situation, I'll bet you money that's going to be the only Wi-Fi hotspot there. So it's not going to be hard for the people to figure out which one to use. It's an incoming-only connection. You can't connect to other Wi-Fi. It's a hotspot. It's got pretty good signal coverage. And in the PiGate, I've disabled the routing of the the Wi-Fi hotspot to the Pi's Ethernet port just for kind of like security reasons. Also, it was pretty easy to do. Also had to have a web server and a web mail application for the people to be able to use. Web server is Apache only because it's more than half of the websites in the world use Apache. It's a great software application. I chose Squirrel Mail because I'm familiar with Squirrel Mail, and it's easy to use, powerful, and it's customizable. The whole thing's written in PHP. So you can change it to whatever you want. So I had to make some changes to the Squirrel Mail software to get it to work in the PiGate. And they don't care. You can do whatever you want to with it. PostFix and XM4, mail transfer agents that actually transfer the email between the email client and the PackLink software. XM4 is for outgoing email. Some PostFix files are needed for the incoming mail. Now, people will say to you, you can't have two mail transfer agents on there at the same time. And they're true. It's right. But I needed some of the PostFix software parts. So what I did is you install PostFix first, and then you install XM4. It overwrites the PostFix, but it leaves some of the configuration files there, which are the ones that I needed. It's a little trick. Dovecot is the IMAP server that connects the PiGate email system, either the web-based email client or the one that's on your smartphone. You can use an IMAP application on your smartphone to connect to the PiGate. Although I wouldn't do it unless you want to spend all your time at a disaster site helping people to figure out how to get their email app configured. So don't do it there. Do it at home like I do just for the fun of it because you can do it. Here's how the email flows. On the left-hand side, you got the users with their tablet or their laptop or their smartphone that connect to the PiGate email server using HTTP or IMAP. Through the Wi-Fi hotspot, it goes through the XM4 mail transfer agents to the PackLink software, which then picks one of its three methods to transmit the email, depending on what station you're going to pull through. We'll talk about that in a moment. Now I'm finished. I've got it all worked. I'm not finished with the talk. I'm finished with the PiGate. I've got the thing built. It works. So now it's time to do some field testing, because obviously field testing is where you find all the problems, right? So my first field day was enlightening. Now, these are not pictures of my first field day. These are just general pictures that I got of field day. Of course, I don't know if any of you remember the field day up in the upper left-hand side. That was probably field day number one. But these are just general images of what field day looks like if you've ever been out on a field day site. So I went out in June on this past field day, and I set up in a shelter like down in the lower right. And I set up on a table like on the left-hand side there, and I put my radio there, and I had the PiGate there, and I had all the wires hooked up, and I had a little crappy whip antenna that I stuck on the top of a table, and I was trying to communicate to this guy's RMS station, which was only like 4 miles away, and it was flaky. I'm thinking, this stinks. This isn't how this is supposed to work. So I thought about it some more. I said, well, my car has got a great communication system in it. Where's my car? It's parked out in a parking lot. I got a great antenna on there. I got a 75-watt radio in there. Says, why don't I just use my car? Why do I try to set up another station inside of this shelter? But how am I going to reach it? I mean, do I need a 200-foot serial cable to go from the PiGate to my car? So I thought about it some more. I said, hey, let's replace this old-school traditional packet setup, which is what I was doing, with this new hotness method of you use your cell phone that connects to it through Wi-Fi, and you got the PiGate is sitting in your car or in your truck using the radio system that you have there. This is great. So let's talk about the Wi-Fi hotspot coverage. Only text is being transmitted. There's no there's one little graphic, the Aries logo. It's only text. So you can be at the very periphery of the Wi-Fi signal, and it'll work just as good as if you're standing right next to it. In the case of the PiGate 3, or the Pi 3, it's about 200 feet. I measured that. I stuck a little table out in the middle. I got a 3-acre field out of my little mini farm. I put a little table out in the middle of the field, and then I walked a 200-foot circle around there, and I was able to contact the PiGate without any trouble. It's about 65 feet or 75 feet inside of a building or within a building. I took my PiGate, I put it on my car, and I parked my car in the driveway, and I took my wife's big van, and I parked it between my car and the house, and I went in the house, and 75 feet away, I was still able to work make contact to the PiGate. So if you need more room, just get an extender. I mean, from Walmart. They're cheap. This cost me $35 from eBay. Some of the extenders advertise that they can extend the signal out for 400 feet. So you add the 400 feet of the extender plus the 200 feet for the PiGate, that's 600 feet. That's 200 yards. So you can have your car parked, you know, in Lower Swabovia, not that quite that far. You can have it parked across the street and be in a disaster site right here, and you walk into the disaster site, and you say, hey, anybody want to send an email to their family? This is all you need. Or a tablet would be even nicer. It's all Part 15 rules. You just buy the stuff. Or if you want to have an extended coverage, you put it in as part of a mesh or an RDN network. You create the mesh network. You add the PiGate as the mesh node. You advertise a web service. Poof. It could be now your truck or your car can be miles away, sitting on top of a nice big hill. Or better yet, sitting on top of a big 400-foot building that has to have a specially designed radio shack sitting on top of there just for that purpose. This is great. So you don't have to carry all this stuff with you into a disaster area. So how do the users use it? Well, they use their smartphone. Everybody's going to have a smartphone. When you go to a disaster site, everybody's still going to have their smartphone with them. It may not work, but they're going to have it with them. You give them the Wi-Fi information. Remember I said you turn on the PiGate, the only Wi-Fi that's going to show up in existence is going to be that PiGate. You tell them you connect to it. They all know how to do it. You touch the button, it says connect, ask for the password, you give them the password, which the default is Raspberry. You can change all this stuff if you want to. And you give them, then you tell them to bring up their web browser, go to that email address, 10.10.10.10/email.php. They'll get the login on the right-hand side there. The PiGate email server login. You give them a username and password, which for an account that you've already set up, or if you want to, you give everybody the same account. I don't care. It might be confusing to them if you have five people all using the same account, but you can create an account for them, and then when you're done, you can delete the account, whatever you want to do. They log in. You can have 5, 10, 15, I forget, the DHCP server, I think I've got it set up to serve up 50 addresses at the same time, but that can be changed. It can be changed to 100, because when they log in on their smartphone, they're going to get a DHCP address. And they can all send email. All you have to do is once you walk in, you set up the PiGate, which is going to be out in your car, out in the parking lot. You give them this information, then you go have some free coffee, because they're going to do all the work. You're not going to do anything. No standing in line. It's designed to be used on a touchscreen. On my phone, it works just fine. It's a very simple menu system. You touch the menu items and they execute. You fill out maybe a text box or two. You touch a couple radio buttons. That's all there is to it. It works great with a tablet or an iPad because you got a bigger screen. Here's what the email web application looks like. This is Squirrel Mail that I've modified a little bit. It's a fully functional email application. They can have their own address book. They can make their own folders. Of course, they're not going to do that. I don't know whether I need all this stuff on there anyway. Maybe I'll take it off. But it's a fully functional email. They hit the compose button. They type their email message. They hit send. They're done. You can also send text messages to cell phones. Just about all of the cell net providers have a special email address that you can use. In my case, for AT&T, it's myphonenumber@txt.att.com. Or net, I'm sorry, .net. you send a text message to that email, and they will send it as an SMS message to your phone. So what I've done in the PiGate is that it'll look at the address that you use, and if it sees it as a phone number, it'll adjust the message size so it's just a smaller message, so you won't get all this extra verbiage that you get with an email. You haven't tried that yet, have you? Okay, you should try that. Actually, this comes in this version, 1.3, sorry. Here's what the web-based administration software. Now, you're the amateur operator. This is your station. You're in charge of it. You got to administer it. You got to set up the time. Remember when the guy was talking about time? You get the computers get a time off of off the net using NTP. Well, if you're not connected, you're in a disaster site. There's no network. You're not going to get any time. When you turn this thing on, the time it's going to display is going to be the time it was when you turned it off the last time. So if it has been 2 months since you turned it on, you don't want your email users sending out emails that are 2 months old. It's going to confuse the people that are getting it. So you want to set the time. So there's a provision here to manually set the time and also the time zone. Change the Wi-Fi SSID and the password and set up all sorts of other things. View the packet logs, add and delete users. This is all stuff that you as the administrator would set up. And then when you're done, you exit out of it and it brings you to a status page. And the status page just sits there and updates it every 15 seconds, I think. Shows you whether the AX25 service is running, which you're going to need running if you're sending out email through a packet. How many messages are in the queue? If you're in a disaster site, you should sit there and watch that message queue start going up. And every time the RMS station is pulled, it drops down to zero, and then it goes up again. If you see a message is climbing and nothing's happened, well, you got to figure out what something's wrong. Or if the RMS pole goes to failure, you need to find out why. The PiGate is also what I call Winlink Global Network Aware. It has a list of all of the RMS stations in the PiGate. And the amateur operator then selects which RMS stations they're going to contact, whether it's a VHF packet or whether it's HF PACTOR. As long as there's a reachable RMS station that you can get to and that is still connected to the internet, the worldwide email capability exists. It'll switch automatically, like I said, between the different modes depending on what kind of station you have selected. If you selected an RMS VHF packet station, it'll use packet. If you selected an HF station, it'll use PACTOR. It'll just pick between the two. Or if you selected a direct internet connection, if it exists. It also has, I have added in version 1.3, which is forthcoming, I've downloaded data on all the RMS stations. I use my QRZ.com account, and I downloaded all the data on all the RMS, all the 700 and some RMS stations, including their latitude and longitude, everything about them. And that'll come in the next version of the software. The reason for that is that so that when you come up with a list of RMS stations, it'll now show you the distance between where you're at and they are. So that's kind of neat. All the email is automatically transferred. When somebody creates an email and they hit the send button, the email goes into the outbound message queue and it sits there until an RMS station is polled. The RMS stations can be polled on regular intervals. The intervals I set up are every 10 minutes or every 20 minutes or every 30 minutes. Or they can be set up on an on-demand poll. It'll do nothing until a message shows up in the message queue and then it'll transmit the message. Or it can be manually polled. You can just press the link and it'll run the poll. Caveats, there's some. There's only one Winlink 2000 email account can be used. It's going to be your Winlink email account. If you don't have a Winlink email account, get one. It's free. All you got to do is winlink.org, sign up for it, you're in. You have to use it like once every 400 days or something like that. But that's pretty easy to do. They also have a web-based interface that you can go to. All this stuff can be easily changed in the web management software, like your Winlink 2000 address and password. Right now, email replies are not allowed. That's a standard e-com practice, because you don't want a lot of people trying to send email into the disaster site saying, what about this, what about that, who's about this, you know, how are they? You just want outbound going email messages and nothing coming back in. So right now, when you send an email message out, the reply address will be nocall@winlink.org. So they can't reply. Now, there are people who have asked that be turned off for them, and I can tell you how to do it. Also, no email attachments are allowed. And the reason for that is that you don't want, you know, Jim, disaster victim, standing out there with his cell phone, typing a message saying, We are okay, but the house is toast. Oh, by the way, here's a picture, and attach a 4 megabyte picture to the email. It's not going to get sent. The system's going to bog down trying to send it, and it's just going to be a waste of time. So no emails, attachments are allowed right now. This is also very easy to maintain. It's the micro SD card is the hard drive. You pull out the micro SD card, you stick it in your Windows laptop, you copy that image to your Windows laptop, it's backed up. Any of the other changes, and then you can copy that image to other PiGates and make minor configuration changes that you need. I would have several mini SD cards on hand because they do go bad once in a while, and perhaps more than one PiGate if I'm on site at a disaster site. You never know what's going to happen. Okay, ongoing development in no particular order. Ideas are welcome. If you have an idea for how this could be used even outside of an e-com scenario, let me know. GPS support is the one I'm working on now. I got this nifty little GPS receiver here for $35 from Amazon. It plugs into the USB port, and the PiGate recognizes it as a serial device, and you could configure the software to use that device for as a UPS. And right now, what I've got it configured to do is that when you turn on the PiGate, it'll look to see if there's a GPS device attached. If there is, it'll try to grab the time and the location from it. If it can do that, it'll update the system time on the PiGate, which is fixes that problem where you don't have to manually update it. And it also set your location. And when it does that, then it'll use that location to figure out what your Maidenhead grid square is. And then when it figures out your Maidenhead grid square, say that 5 times fast, it'll go through the list of RMS stations and pick all the RMS stations that are in the same grid square and populate your list of ones that you can use. So those are the ones that are going to be closest to you. And it works, it takes like a couple seconds. It's pretty fast. If I decide to allow email replies, there has to be some way to be able to parse out individual email users from, because all the replies are going to come back to your call sign at winlink.org. And if they're separate users, there's got to be a way to be able to separate those users out so people can get replies coming back that'll go into their account. I'm still working on that. Adding HTML documents as an attachment is something I'm working on. What I want to be able to do is have documents like the ARL radiogram or the ICS 213 or other forms like that on the PiGate as an HTML form. You can bring them up in your web browser. You can fill in the form. You save it. When it saves it as an HTML document and attaches it to your email. Now, that'll only be about 2 or 3 or 4K. But on the receiving end, when they get it, they just click on the attachment and it pops up in their web browser, or they can do whatever they want to with it, print it or whatever. Requesting email text bulletins. This is something I'm working on now, where you can send out a text and do a request to get a bulletin or some sort of a file back as an email. It works pretty nice. You can get weather data. You can get the ARRL weekly summaries, DX reports. All that kind of stuff is all available from email requests. You just send out an email and get it back. Now, the nice thing, if you're at a disaster site and you're there for 2 or 3 days, wouldn't it be nice to have maybe an hourly weather report? You'd like to know if there's like another tornado coming? That would be kind of nice to have. You know, because if you don't have the internet, you're at a disaster site, how are you going to know unless you watch the weather and say, oh, look, there's a funnel cloud. Also, I'm trying to make support for Raspberry Pi displays, both the 7-inch and the 3.5-inch display. I'm not sure yet how exactly I'm going to do that. It does support it. They do work. But I haven't decided what I'm going to display on there. You know, I really don't want to rewrite the management software just to work on that display because it works so fine on the web browser. So I have to think of other things. Anybody have any ideas, let me know. Enhanced support for PackTor devices. Right now, the serial PackTor software works great if you happen to have an old PackTor 2 modem, because that was what the modem that the guy had who wrote the software. So it works great with that, or ones that are similar to that. What I'm trying to do is add support for other devices where you can give it a series of initialization strings or something like that, that it'll send it to the modem to get it ready to transmit in PackTor mode. I've got it working. It works okay, but it's only right now specific to my little PK232. I'm trying to make it a little more generic, so I'm working on that now. Also, for optimized link state routing support native to the PiGate, I'm working on that. I haven't worked too much on it. I got the software. I started playing around with it. That would be kind of nice to have. And one guy wanted to know if I can help him get weather data for the boating and the yachting crowd. He'd like to be able to get, you know, weather facsimiles and things like that as attachments to emails coming back. So I'm looking at doing that. So any other ideas that you have would be very useful. Power considerations. Like you said, the Raspberry Pi runs about 10 hours on a battery like this. It only uses 5 volts. And of course, the radio needs 12 volts. I wouldn't have this radio and the PiGate running off the same battery, because as soon as you key up the radio, it's going to drop the power just enough to where the PiGate will probably reboot. They're very sensitive to power. Two of these batteries in parallel with a solar array probably give you 24/7 capability. Well, where do I get a PiGate? Well, you go to PiGate.net. All the files are freely downloadable. The software is distributed as an image. You just take that image, burn it onto your SD card, plug it into your PiGate, turn it on. It works just fine. It's all set up that you make your little minor configuration changes that you need to make for your call sign or your password, and if you want to change the name of the PiGate, Wi-Fi, SSID, things like that. You can also download the image files for the 3D printer, or so you can print your own case. Or you can go to Brent and get a super nifty custom case with your name in there and all that kind of stuff. And it's also printed on glass, so it's all nice and smooth and shiny. The Raspberry Pi computer you get for all sorts of places. I get mine from MCM Electronics. Be careful, because some of these places charge more than $35 for the $35 Raspberry Pi. TNC Pi is only available from John Hansen at Coastal Chipworks. John is a great guy. You order a TNC Pi by noon, he'll probably ship it to you that day. He's pretty good at that. If you want a fully assembled and a tested Pi gate from me, I'll do that for you for a fee. It's on the website. Go to PiGate.net. It has all the information. We need more RMS stations around the country. There's all sorts of repeaters. Every club has got a repeater. If you got a repeater, you probably have everything you need to set up an RMS station. So you go to winglink.org and look at the information there, how to become a sysop, right? How to become a sysop. And the software is freely downloadable. It's easy to set up. There's versions for Linux, versions for Windows. We need more RMS stations around the world to give us more coverage, especially for those people in North Dakota and South Dakota. If you live in those two states, do them all a favor. Okay, there's all the references. If you want to look at these references, you can build one on your own. You don't need to figure it out from me, but, you know, good luck. And that's it. So now we have ample time for questions.
W2LNX, David. So as a control operator, how do you vet the messages that, assuming the civilians, non-hams in the shelter, have queued up on your?
Well, you really
so what
can.
What do you do?
You really can. I mean, you have to. What I recommend you do is you give them a piece of paper that says, I blah, 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 agree not to do this stuff. I checked this out with my lawyer, and he said, if you do that and they sign it and you keep a copy of it, you're going to be, relieved from any responsibility. But what I do is I do not allow the users to delete any emails. So any emails they sent will stay on there, and it can be used for auditing purposes later on in case something like that comes up.
On your one comment that you can email to a cell phone number via the carrier,
right?
That only works if the recipient actually has cell coverage. So you don't have people in your shelter trying to send emails to the person in the next shelter over that doesn't
right.
have cell coverage.
Yeah, that's so true.
It's obvious to most people, but sometimes it's worth stating. And an idea for a future enhancement, for operators that don't mind doing it, provide a way that the user can automatically configure their own account so you don't have to go in and pre-configure all the accounts and they're not all lumped under one username.
Yeah, that would be difficult, I think. But, okay, thank you.
John Hansen, W2FS.
Hi, John.
Hi. I just wanted to say that I did bring a few of the TNC Pi kits and wired and tested versions, and I'll be in the demonstration room for a little while after the Tapper meeting is over.
And I have to say that out of all the ones I've built, There's never been a failure on any of the TNCs. There's never been a failure on any of the Raspberry Pis either, so. But I do test them. You got a guy here?
One more question.
Michael Fox, N6MEF. You mentioned you're using both PostFix and XM4. Why two different MTAs?
Well, because like I said, the way I set it up required some of the PostFix files, but if you install, I had to use XM4 to give it the capability that worked between the email application and the Pactor software. So, I installed PostFix first to be able to get the PostFix configuration files, and then I installed XM4, which overwrote PostFix but left the configuration files there, which is what I wanted. So it doesn't use PostFix, it just uses some of the configuration files. It's maybe a little kludgy way of doing it, but it worked, and hey.
Okay, thank you very much.